And we wanted to just conclude the day with a conversation with Jim Coulter, who will bring it all together and let us know what our next steps are. So, Jim, thank you for your leadership again and coming back to the mic.
Uh-oh.
Jacket's coming off.
Think better with the jacket off since this is all made up on the fly. So we'll end up pretty quickly, but I want to give you a few thoughts to perhaps walk away. And the first is a little bit of a tweet from me. There's a quote from F. Scott Fitzgerald that says, the sign of a first-rate intelligence is the ability to hold two opposing ideas in your mind and still function. This room is filled with a lot of first-rate intelligence, so we've got two ideas I want to leave you with. The first is education is enormously complicated, emotional, and difficult. And as we think about technology in that area, it has to be an education solution. The other, as I sat over here as someone who looks at lots of industries, there are a ton of industries that have gone through technological change and innovation. So the one thing I think that was missing a little bit from our discussion today is what have we learned from other industries? Because this will happen. It will be good for education. The question is, how can we have it happen in a good way? So I want to just kind of randomly go through some ideas that were running through my head in terms of things we haven't talked about that other industries have deeply ingrained in terms of their ability to build professional development. The second is, think about doctors, lawyers, and pilots. These are very professionally driven organizations, but their organizations or their regulators put in place standards because you have to keep up in the law and in medicine. Do we have standards in this industry? If the union wants to do something, why don't we have things that you might certify for teachers to be technologically ready? And next time you go into union negotiation, you say, if you give us more time, we'll deliver half of your teachers that are technologically enabled. Wouldn't a district like that? Yeah, you know, so doctors have to go through continuing education. How do we get into our industry the idea of teachers needing to have continued education, not just being offered it? Next, teach tech with tech. There's some really interesting programs out there. We've been looking at some of these companies that do professional development for programmers and other tech professionals. And what do they use? They use videos, online tests, et cetera. So we have this ingrained in this industry idea that professional development is done in time outside of the classroom. You know, people are asleep and you have to do it when we say you do it. Other industries have figured out how to do professional development on demand when people want to do it and have the time to do it in really interesting and engaging ways. So shouldn't we teach our teachers to use tech using tech? Encourage platforms. This is a rugged, individualist industry. You know, I'm always amazed at the discussion over standards. I know how hard it is, but industries have standards, and we need to get the right ones. But there is something that happens in technology. Android and Apple systems have developed not a problem by being two main mobile systems, but a huge amount of creativity, because creativity can come together on a platform. So we as an industry need to sort of adopt and encourage some platforms, whether it's graphite or other things that people can come to. Right now there's too many places to go and no standardization. So how do we as an industry think about platforms that people can organize professional development around? Which is something for all of you to think in your actual system. We have a tendency not to want to standardize. I mean, if I think about Mooresville, you guys standardized. I mean, you had a lot of creativity, but you said, we're going to do it this way. And people think of standardization as somehow an impingement on the teacher's ability to be creative. But in fact, standardization leads to collaboration, which leads to creativity. And so we have to break through this concept that every teacher is going to do it their own way, and we have to come through some level of standardization, which then allows people to do it their own way. You didn't have iPhone apps until everyone had an iPhone and an operating system that those apps could be developed on. So within your own system, you're going to have to force through a little more standardization, even though it's going to be against the ethos of this industry, because that's going to be what allows the creativity to happen. Lean on vendors. We would not in any of our companies buy an SAP product if they didn't put a ton of money in for user support. So somehow in this industry, everyone wants to kind of buy unbundled. You should bundle more and make the vendors pay. right? They will. They're happy to if you give them a chance to, but because everyone wants to keep this non-standardization, individualization thing going on, you can't get the dollars in. They should pay to be in your schools for the first go-round, and you should use that money for professional development. I mean, it's there for every accounting software. It's there for every Salesforce software. You know, why isn't it there for educational software? I think we have to ask more aggressively. Talked a lot about failure. I want to say something that is uncomfortable for me to say, but people are going to fail here, right? When we went through a technological change, the automobiles, which were just carriages with engines in them, there were some carriage makers, if you read the history, that became the new car makers, and there's some people that had to find new careers. So there will be teachers who are going to fail. And if we don't make it a teacher's responsibility to be better with technology, not just an opportunity, a responsibility, and if we don't hold them accountable over time, we are not doing the right thing for our kids. So anytime any industry goes through a technological change, the workforce has to go with it. And at the end of the day, I love teachers, but teachers have to get better. And if today's education requires engines to be in that carriage, then we better become car makers and not think we're going to be carriage makers for the rest of our career, because life is moving on. And lastly, user groups. We tend to think districts, and we tend to think historical lines of communication. I heard it a couple times today, but one of the things other technologically transitional industries have gone through is all of a sudden the learning is horizontal. So Mark, you ought to have your third grade teacher create a Mooresville user group for third grade teachers around the country and have the information travel that way. I know there's a lot of that going on, but we tend to still think in kind of historical state, district, you know, school, as opposed to horizontal professional development. So let's kind of push that if we can. And the last point, the use of certification. Teachers love certification, right? And I want you to think about LEED Platinum buildings. If any of you have been, this is a different LEED. If you've ever been a LEED Platinum, LEED Gold, but what, you know what that is? No one knows what it is, but someone came up with a set of standards and they certify it and everyone builds to that. Why? Because they want to have a gold building or a platinum building. Our teachers desperately want to be tech enabled. That's what all the data says, but they don't know what it means and no one certifies them on it. So could someone just come up with some standards that say, you know, these teachers are certified, you know, because if with a little bit of thing to shoot for, I think teachers will spend weekends, vacations, personal times, holidays, you know, if you give them something they can get certified on and then go back to their district and get something for it, they will do it. Again, move the cat food, and part of the cat food in education is certification of skills. And we haven't done that here. So let's find a way to do it. Some highlights from today, and this is, Caroline, in my view, it's some Twitter reading, but system needs to take more risk urgently. We're still talking a lot about things that could go wrong. We need to kind of get into things that could go right here. I love this. It came across blockbuster schools. You know, schools are still like Blockbuster. The kids are all on Netflix. Let's catch up to the kids. It's not one size fits all. The good news about technology is you can personalize, but we have to balance that with the fact that one size fits all. Imagine if a company allowed everyone to have their own tech solution in the office every day. If you know, so you have to basically have a system that everyone signs into, and then you one size fit all within it. We need to trust and engage our teachers. Flexible problem solvers, I totally agree. This is about empowering teachers. It's one-to-one-to-one. Time. I think this is one of the key elements. But if people want more time, let's figure out some way to really certify and talk about what you're going to do with that time. And absolutely, we should open up more time in the day. The question is, how do we fill it? Leadership, at the end of the day, before the personalization can happen, a few people have to step forward and take leadership. And that's what you see in the school districts that have really made a difference. And so one of the things I think we all need to talk about is, how do we lead the leaders? How are we going to find the people around the country who are going to take the steps and lead that development? District needs to provide the vision. This is along the same point. We can't just say do PD on technology. We have to create programs that differentiate us. And lastly, we keep getting into politics, into schools, you know, charter, not unions. You know, it's not about politics, not about school politics. We absolutely have to break through that for collaboration. You know, we're seeing that happening very painfully in the FCC, you know, just breaking through on this question of how do you actually get some money to solve this problem. If they're doing it, we ought to be able to do it within our community. So here's something we're trying to lead, and this is not an announcement, but it's something that we'd like help from with all of you. The Department of Ed is working on a program to get future-ready schools, where they're asking for schools to take a pledge to be future-ready. The question is, how do you do that? So we're going to get a bunch of superintendents who are going to sign a pledge, and then the question is, now what? So we're looking at taking the best of EdTech summits on the road. You all have summits. You all have do great things. There's some awesome summits around the country. But the problem is, in the aftermath of this, we need to get them local. We need to get people there and have them see the best of what all you do. I mean, imagine getting Sean and Mark to in front of people who have never seen ed tech and really sell it in a way that gets people excited. One of the things we've learned from watching Apple or other people put out products is you do a big event, you get the best of it, you show how it works, and then let the flywheel get going. So we're thinking about doing this next year, and we'd love to hear from all of you as to if you have something you've seen really work at a summit or a conference somewhere that got people excited about educational technology, just shoot us who that speaker was, what it was, and we're going to try to see if we could put together a program and help be the bully pulpit on this. That's all LEAD is. You know, you guys do all the work. We get to be a bully pulpit, and hopefully by bringing it now, you know, at the end of the day, it can't be in rooms like this. We have to get it into the field to the leaders of schools because the market is now ready. So if you want to get involved in this idea, we have a couple of emails up here. Please send us your thoughts, and we'd appreciate it. So Jim Shelton gave us a call to action. This is about collaboration within this room and without. If we can help you at LEAD, we're happy to do so. But most importantly, we want to thank you for helping us, because just by being here, we're picking up the dialogue and hopefully stepping on the way to more creative solutions. My partner, Jim Steyer, anything you want to add?
With or without a microphone, we will summarize this. But no, I just think when we look at the little more than 2 years we've been working on this, the progress is phenomenal and the potential is really there. We all know this. And even to the questions you had, Frank, about what's going to happen.